The last four videos were devoted to helping you build an effective study system. Now it's vitally important to make sure that that study system does the job that you want it to, and that is to help you remember the things that you are studying. To help you achieve this goal, this video and the two following videos will be devoted to explaining how your memory works and how you can use this knowledge to study more effectively. G'day, and welcome to Crystal Clear Mathematics, where it is easier than you think. I'm your host, Graham Henderson. Memory researchers have learned that we all have three types of memory that use different parts of our brain: immediate memory, working memory, and long-term memory. Except where there is heightened emotional involvement or trauma, everything that you remember has to pass through these three phases of your memory. If any part fails, you will not remember the material. Your immediate memory can store just a few items for up to about half a minute. After this time, unless the information is very important, it's forgotten. In fact, it has to be important to us to even be noticed in the first place. We're inundated with information through our senses constantly, yet we're only aware of sensations that we choose to notice or that are important to us. For example, I'd like you to breathe normally through your nose, but be aware of the air rushing over your upper lip as you exhale. This sensation has been there ever since you were born, but you only noticed it now when you chose to and because it became important to you as part of what I'm sharing. Let's place this in the context of a lesson or a lecture or doing your homework or study. When the teacher says, open your textbooks to page 127 and get out your protractor, you only have to remember this information long enough to do the task. If you're not interested or you're not paying attention, you don't even register the information in your immediate memory at all. And if you don't pay attention or notice these things, if you're too distracted by the things around you, you've got almost no hope of learning and remembering the information. It's also true that if you were asked a few minutes later what page you were working on, it's likely that you will have forgotten because it wasn't particularly important that you remember that fact, and your brain will have let it disappear from your immediate memory. So, information not only has to be important or relevant to even enter your immediate memory, it also has to be important to you in order for your brain to want to keep it. Notice that I didn't say that it had to be interesting, or even that you had to like what you were learning, or like the person who's teaching you. That will come later, as we'll see. Simply put, to register something in your immediate memory, you must consider it important and choose to learn it. Now, I want you to make a curious but vitally important observation. Good use of your immediate memory requires intention and importance. Yet these aren't passive things. Nobody makes you intend to do something or makes you think that something's important. These are not things that happen to you, they're choices that you make. So, the word that I want you to associate with immediate memory is choice. You can choose whether or not you intend to listen and pay attention. You can choose whether you will consider something as being important for you and whether you will pay attention to it. In other words, you can choose whether or not you want something to enter your immediate memory and enter the learning process. If you choose not to pay attention in class or not to pay attention when completing your homework or study, for example, your chances of successful learning are very low indeed. To be a successful student, you need to ask the following kinds of questions to make the best use of your immediate memory. Will I choose to learn? Will I pay attention in class? Will I work with as few distractions as possible? Will I choose to regard the material as important and intend to learn it? Now, I'm not trying to be harsh. I simply want to make you aware of how your mind works and what you can do to improve your ability to remember things. Students who pay attention during lessons and pay attention to and focus on their homework and study have to exert far less effort to remember than those who don't pay attention. The second kind of memory is called working memory. When information has been passed from your immediate memory to your working memory, it's possible to keep really important items here for up to a few days, for example, remembering that you have to hand your assignment in on Friday. But usually, you can only maintain each item in your working memory for 10 to 20 minutes, unless something different happens to make the item new and interesting again. If boredom or fatigue sets in, it's likely that your working memory will dump the item in favour of something else. So it helps if you can change how you're doing something or change what you're doing every 10 to 20 minutes in order to keep refreshing your working memory. Create lots of small goals and challenges in your learning. For example, if you've got 10 questions to do for homework, time yourself on the first two and race the clock for the remaining eight. It's your responsibility to create your own variety and challenges, no matter what you choose to learn. So be creative and discuss your learning strategies with others so that you can learn from them and they can learn from you. I find it quite amazing that students in Australia spend 13 years in school and almost never have a lesson on how to learn. Also, most of us can only keep about 7 items in our working memory at any one time. This means that you must be careful not to clutter your working memory. Effective study is done when you concentrate on fewer things. Do not try to multitask. That is, watching television, chatting on Facebook, texting friends, listening to a favourite song while trying to do your mathematics homework, especially if you have different kinds of questions to solve. It is also important that you change your approach to your work regularly. Summarising for a while, solving some questions a particular way, checking answers by substituting, racing the clock, etc. This variety keeps your working memory on track. Working memory is great for rote rehearsal of things like times tables and facts and definitions and some basic skills, especially if there's a sense of excitement like racing the clock or tension if you're being quizzed by someone. Working memory is also very good for what researchers call elaborative rehearsal, where you spend enough time with the material to start to see its connection or relationships with other things that you have learned. When you do homework, you should be looking for links like this because each connection that you make greatly enhances your chances of remembering the material. You might be studying trigonometry, for example, and suddenly realize how it's connected to Pythagoras' theorem. These links also help you to solve higher order problems that only the better students can manage. Now, in the interest of keeping each video to a manageable time, we're going to stop here and we'll discuss your long-term memory in the next 2 videos. This is Graham Henderson, encouraging you to become familiar with your memory and also encouraging you to learn how to learn. Please subscribe, like, or comment on this video. Thank you.